Oh, it's so good to see you again tonight. Thank you for allowing us into your home. Tonight we're going to be looking at Psalms chapter 84, Psalms 84. So if you have your copy of Scripture, go ahead and turn there for me if you will, because we're about to jump right into it, kind of set you up what's taking place within the Psalm or as the Psalm is being written. So Psalms chapter 84, this is the subscript is to the chief musician on the instrument of Gath, a psalm of the sons of Korah, which means we don't exactly know the time frame, exact time frame when the psalm was written, but it's going to be obvious what the songwriter is longing for. How lovely is your tabernacle, O Lord of hosts. My soul longs, yes, even faints, for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh cry out for the living God. Even the sparrow has found a home, and the swallow a nest for herself, where she may lay her young, even your altars, O Lord of hosts, my King and my God. Blessed are those who dwell in your house. They will still be praising you. Blessed is the man whose strength is in you, whose heart is set on pilgrimage. As they pass through the valley of Baca, they make it a spring. The rain also covers it with pools. They go from strength to strength. Each one appears before God in Zion. O Lord God of hosts, hear my prayer and give ear. O God of Jacob, Selah. O God, behold our shield and look upon the face of your anointed. For a day in your courts is better than a thousand. I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than dwell in the tents of wickedness. For the Lord God is a sun and shield. The Lord will give grace and glory. No good thing will he withhold from those who walk uprightly. O Lord of hosts, blessed is the man who trusts in you. Now, there are some biblical scholars that believe the writer of this psalm was perhaps prevented from traveling to one of the three annual feasts that were held in Jerusalem. Now, it was necessary for you to attend at least one of the feasts every year in Jerusalem. It was required by law from the Jews. But this particular man, who one of the sons of Korah, who wrote this song, was unable to attend one of those feasts, and he is devastated by the fact that he cannot go and worship in Jerusalem. Now, there were three feasts every year that were to celebrate the provision for the Israelites. One, God setting them free from captivity, that was called Passover, and then you had the other two feasts that were huge feasts that were celebrate God's provision on the people as they made their way through the wilderness. There also reminds them, each one of these feasts reminded them that they were just pilgrims passing through a land. And we also need to remember that we are just pilgrims passing through a strange land. Warren Wiersbe once said, a vagabond is a person who has no home. A fugitive is one who is running from home. A stranger is one who is away from his home. And a pilgrim is someone who is headed towards a home. And we are pilgrims. The psalmist's inability to attend the feast, however, did not rob him of his ability to worship. He found a place where he was, even though he was heartbroken that he would not be able to attend the feast. He made a tabernacle, he made a temple where he was, and he wrote down his worship experience with the Lord. This was a man who longed to worship the Lord. This was a man who knew how to worship the Lord, regardless of what his circumstances were, regardless of what his situation was, regardless of what his surroundings were. This was a man who knew how to get a hold of the Lord. So there are two things that we're going to talk about this evening. The one is there is the desire of the worshiper. The worshiper has several desires. There is the desire to be in the presence of God. We see this in verse number 1 and 2. How lovely is your tabernacle, O Lord God of hosts. My soul longs, yes, even faints, for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh cry out for the living God. It's often been said that you love what you worship and you worship what you love. So whatever you love, you will worship. Whatever you worship is what you love. And so one of the things that we have to look at in our own lives, what is it that I worship? What do I spend the most of my time worshiping? And there are times that we may not consider that what we give the utmost priority to in our life, we might not consider that worship, but that's really what it is. We're saying with our hearts and with our minds, with our choices, with our actions, that we place this one thing above all other things, and that would be what you worship. And you will make time for whatever it is that you love and whatever it is that you worship. And here the son of Korah is saying, man, I desire to be in God's house, not just now, but I desire to be in God's house continually. He had a longing within him to always be within the house of the Lord. So there is a desire to be in the presence of God when you are a true worshiper. We are all aware that there is a strong desire for us to be close, to be with the object of our worship or the object of our love. Almost every morning throughout the week, Monday, Misty and I are now sharing the day off. She's off on Monday, so I made my day off on Monday so that we could share the day together. But on most days, there's this time in the morning that we have our coffee, we have our breakfast, we chat for a little while, and then it's time for us to get in our vehicles, and she goes into Huntsville to work, and I come here to Farley to work. And there's this time for about 10 to 12 hours of separation. But during those 10 to 12 hours, there's a longing that I have to be reunited with her at the end of the day. There's a longing that I have throughout the day to see her, to talk to her, to be with her. Why is that longing there? Because she is the object of my love. I love my wife, and therefore I want to spend time with her. I want to be around her. I want to be able to share life with her, to share life experiences with her. You love what you worship, and you worship what you love, and there's this strong desire to be with the person that you love. And Asaph, or it's not Asaph, sorry, we've been talking a lot about him lately, but here the writer is saying, man, I want to be in God's presence because I love him more than anything else. There's a desire to fellowship with God. We see that in verse number 8, O Lord God of hosts, hear my prayer. Give ear, O God of Jacob, Selah. And so this is a little bit different than what we've read from the songs of Asaph, even from some of the songs of David. This is not like a devastating cry for, Lord, you have to hear my prayer. This is not coming from a crisis point in his life. This is coming from a longing for to be heard by God, just in his prayer and his fellowship. Hey, God, I want to spend time with you. So lend your ear to me so that we can fellowship together. And all of you know that one-sided conversations aren't usually very fun. And I often find myself in trouble because Misty will be having a conversation with me and my ADD kicks in sometimes rather quickly, and I have already moved on to the squirrel in the backyard or the tree rustling through the window, and something else has caught my attention, and my ears are working, but I'm not really hearing what he's saying. Fortunately for us, our God doesn't do that. God doesn't tune out. He doesn't just zone out on us or whatever. We do that for often, and I know Misty gets quite frustrated when I'm hearing but not listening. We have a God who listens all the time. There's this desire of fellowship for us to have a strong connection with God, for us to have the ability to hear from him, because he also wants to hear from us and have that unique fellowship. There's also a desire to be in the service of God. We see in verse number 10, he says, for a day in your courts is better than a thousand. And we sing this song And we have sung the song here at Farley before, better is one day in your courts than a thousand elsewhere. And then he says, I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than to dwell with the wicked. Now, think about that for a second. A lot of times we may have in our mind that the wicked dwell in really horrible places. The wicked dwell in the streets, you know, the drug abusers, the drug addicts, that's where they live. They live out in the streets and the gutters of the world. You know, maybe they're in a hospital or, you know, or the wicked just live in terrible places. But let's not forget, the wicked live in some posh places too. And we see that in our country as well. I mean, we have a lot of wickedness that comes across our TV screens and a lot of wickedness that comes through satellite radio and on radio waves. There's just a lot of wickedness out there. There's a lot of wickedness streaming over the internet. There's a lot of wickedness out there. There's a lot of people who are profiting off of wickedness, who live high on the hog, if you will. They live in really, really good lives. What he's saying is, I know that there could be something, even though it may be harmful, probably is harmful, it's unholy, but I could be out there having fun doing all of those things. But I would rather be in service to you, God. I would rather just be a doorkeeper in your house. A doorkeeper in those days is actually what it says. Someone who stands at the door, who greets guests as they come in by opening or shutting the door. He's also there to stand guard for the master. He said, I would rather just be a door prop. Do nothing else all day long, all night long with my time, then be separated from you. Lord, I want to live my life in service to you. That is the heart of the true worshiper. The true heart of the worshiper is a desire to be in the presence of God, the desire to fellowship with God, the desire to serve God. That is the heart of the true worshiper. Then we see the discovery in verse 4 of the worshiper. He's going to make several discoveries here in this passage. In verse number 4, verses 3 and 4, he says, even the sparrow has found a home. Now, if you have your copy of scripture out, I would encourage you to underline that or highlight that portion, that sentence. Even a sparrow has found a home, and the swallow a nest for herself where she may lay her young. Even your altars, O Lord of hosts, my King and my God. Notice this. Blessed are those who dwell in your house. They will still be praising you. You are blessed in God's presence because you discover as you worship him, as you're fellowshipping with him, and as you're drawing near to him, and as you're studying scripture and you're studying his word, you are discovering that you are not just going to a home that he is preparing for you, but you are at home with God. Paul tells us, do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit? Quite literally, God dwells in you. He has made his home in you. In the meantime, he's living in you until he gets a place ready for you in glory. You are blessed in God's presence. Secondly, you are blessed when God is your strength. Verse number 5, blessed is the man whose strength is in you, whose heart is set on pilgrimage. Why? Why are we blessed when we rely on the Lord for our strength? Well, one, I think it keeps us from making really stupid decisions. It gives the glory to God when we are able to do things under his empowerment, under his leading, under his calling. All the glory goes to him. When all of a sudden people see you accomplishing things that are outside your physical ability, your personality or whatever, God automatically gets the glory for that. I guess I could be a good example of that. I mean, what I am able to do to serve the Lord, no one would have ever thought that I would have been a minister or a pastor. If you'd known me back in my adolescent years and my teen years, is probably you'd say there's no hope for that kid. But God uses, God does the impossible. He just always does the impossible. He does the impossible through people all the time. You are blessed when God is your strength. Look at verse 6. As they pass through the valley of Baca, they make it a spring. The rain also covers it with pool. Now, Baca in Hebrew is a word meaning the balsamic tree. And the sap from this tree, it oozes out like tears. So the Valley of Baca is the name for any difficult and painful place in life where everything seems hopeless and where you feel hopeless. It's like the pit of despair. So he goes, even though they pass through this place of despair, this place of mourning, he says, they make it a spring. The person who has trusted in the Lord, they make it a spring, and the rain also covers it with pools. The people who love God expect to pass through any valley and not remain there. They get a blessing from the experience, and they usually leave a blessing behind. David said this, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Why? For you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. And in the valley, not only did David experience the presence, the blessing of the presence of God, but he penned a beautiful psalm. And so that when we are in the valley, we can go back to that song. We can come back to this song, Psalms 84, and we find a blessing for our journey as well. Verse number 7, they go from strength to strength. Each one appears before God in Zion. So you are blessed in God's presence. You are blessed when God is your strength, and you are blessed with a supernatural defense. Verse 9, O God, behold our shield and look upon the face of your anointed. In verse number 11, it says, for the Lord God is a sun and a shield. The Lord will give grace and glory. Love this. No good thing will he withhold from those who walk uprightly. He is your sun. He is your shield. God has provided you a supernatural defense. And I'll refer you to Ephesians chapter 6, beginning in verse number 10, for what that defense looks like. And you are blessed when you discover that God is all you need. You will be blessed when you discover that God is all you need. And sadly for most of us, we will never understand that God is all we need until we come to a point in time in life when God is all we have. There'll be a crisis that many of us will encounter that no matter how hard we pray or how hard we try or how hard we work or how hard we study, how hard we try to find answers, we'll come up with a goose egg that we'll do everything in our own power to solve a crisis, a problem that we've encountered in life and come up with nothing. We'll come to the place where God is all we have left. And we'll get on our face before God and we'll pour our heart out to God. And then in that moment, as we're pouring our heart out to God and God begins to hear, God begins to respond and God begins to wrap us in his glory, in the glory of his presence, we will begin to understand this is where I needed to be all along, that God is really all I need. You are blessed when you discover, as this psalmist did, that God is all you need. And finally, you are blessed by the knowledge that you can trust God in any and every situation. You can trust God. Get verse number 12. O Lord of hosts, blessed is the man who trusts in you. So questions. When is the last time you could say that your desire was like the author of this psalm? Your desire was that of a true worshiper, one who longed to be in the presence of God continually. The reality is, until you have the desire to be a worshiper, to spend time with God, to pray without ceasing, to worship him throughout your day, that longing that you have to be with him, until you have the desire of a worshiper, you will never make the discoveries that the psalmist made in this passage, that you're blessed in the presence, that you have a home with him, that you're blessed in his strength, that you're blessed with a supernatural defense, and that you're blessed as you learn that you can trust in God. Oh, let God give us the heart of a worshiper. Let God give us a desire to abide in him 24/7. Father, thank you for this passage. I pray that you would help us to examine it more closely. Help us, Father, as we look at this chapter, chapter 84, God, that you would help us to make personal applications. God, that you would speak to my heart directly and what you would have me to do and adjustments that you would have me to make in order to be an authentic worshiper of my God, my Savior, Jesus Christ. God, and I pray that you'd help us all to do that kind of self-examination. God, what am I allowing to get in the way of my time with you, my praise of you, my abiding in you? And God, whatever it is, I pray that you would give me the wisdom and the strength, Lord, to prune that thing out of my life so that your first place, so that your glory, your love, and your presence can consume me, so that the world will see Jesus in me. God, speak to hearts, and we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you, church family. We love you.